If you want to start a boat project but it intimidates you, don't let it. Find me on Patreon and we can get past it.
Hey guys, this is the boat. Here it is. This is after it's already carpeted. I couldn't get any before pictures, but it was pretty tore back. This is a pretty old boat, and by the time, carpet does wear out. Anything wears out. But in my opinion, carpet's still the most durable thing to use on a bass boat, as we're going to show you step-by-step how to install 20-ounce carpet like a boss. Stay tuned and watch the entire thing starting now. This is a local from where I live, and he did the courtesy of actually cleaning the boat. That was the deal, because actually stripping down the carpet and getting all the glue off is a huge pain. But here is the stuff we're going to install inside, and he kept a lot of the templates from the original like carpet job, and that's going to help tremendously when we go to try and reinstall all this. We have the blue teal carpet, which actually looks surprisingly good. I was not sure how that would look, but it really matches this boat and makes it pop very well. We are using this stuff right here. This is directly on our site. In fact, all this carpet can be found on our site. In fact, that's where most of this, actually all this carpet came from. Here are the latches. We're gonna use those to replace the old broken and kind of corroded latches. That's just what happens to latches over time. They break because of the sun. This stuff, I swear, is glorified Elmer's glue, and I actually called around to talk to a few marine buddies who do this for a living out in this town I live in, because it's a boat place, and they use the same stuff. Said it looks like Elmer's glue, but it's what they recommend for marine carpet. So we're putting it all over these fiberglass hatches. We wait to do the sides though, because once we have this, we're just going to flip it over and put it on this piece of carpet, which is upside down right now at the moment. And when we go ahead and press into there, we'll now have a good surface to do the sides. And then we put a pretty copious amount of glue on the inside and outside of the rim of the lid. And we do that because later on we're going to have to clamp it down with something, because that's how we're going to get it to seal and form and stay there. But there's an extra caveat to this. You're going to need something long that you can clamp together along each side of the carpet around the rim, so that it will form in place long enough for the glue to set. And how I did this was just yardsticks and square rulers and adjustable clamps. This worked like a charm. I wish I had more, that way I could do all sides faster, but whatever. I also used a regular utility knife to cut the inside of the excess carpet off. And once it was flush like this, I do it like this. Some people hate this. Some people just cut a 90 degree angle at each end and then seam it together like that. We actually show you how to do that later on, just for a variation of the video. But just so you know, this is how I usually cut the ends of my carpet. Only thing left on this hatch is just to install the latch, which fits in seamlessly because it was already pre-cut for that exact latch. Okay, that's pretty good. Okay, so now this one's done, I'm going to put this one aside and we'll take care of the rest of them. Once you do your first hatch, it's just a redundant process, so we're not going to show you all the other ones we did. We'll just show you a few variants and deviations that we did, like this, where I forgot to show you to make sure you mark and poke holes through where you're going to later on mount the piano hinges, because that's going to cause you a problem. Also, this is the deviant that you can do where you can cut the corners just like this where they meet up flush versus cutting them flush with scissors. Other than that, it's just the same thing. You got a clamp and you have to have it set. If you don't clamp them though, I swear it's the most miserable process. It just helps with the whole forming of the carpet and the adhesion motion part. So the hatches themselves fit pretty nice. Only thing is, we don't have the exterior carpet over the edge of the rim where the hatches actually sit in. So we'll eventually have to go in there with the hair clippers and trim so they all fit correctly. And then we'll have to compensate for the size of the hinge that goes between the carpet and the sides and all that BS. And we're also going to switch up the glue to the standard Lowe's outdoor indoor carpet glue, because that stuff will tack up in like seriously cold weather, and it is seriously cold outside. It conveniently gets always cold right when I want to do something outside. It was great, and then, well, you know how things go. But that's what this stuff is. That's why we switched up the glue, because this stuff will tack in the coldest of weather. It will just tack right up. It's all lathered up in glue. Okay, so far, so good with the layout. We have just enough carpet to span the length, or I'm sorry, the width of the boat. What's bad, though, is that this carpet initially came with a trim that covered the edge of the carpet, and we do not have it. I looked all over this town, and for a town that just does nothing but fabricate boats, like, I couldn't find anything. So it doesn't. I'm kind of annoyed about that, but what we did do is we tucked it very, very tactfully inside the crevice, and we used the other end of the utility knife just like this and just jammed it in there. And once we had a nice good solid jamming and forming of the carpet, then we just cut it clean with a brand new razor blade on the deal, so we didn't have any distortions in the carpet from a dollar blade. And you will go through a lot of razor blades, so prepare to have a few packs of those things on hand when you're doing a job like this. This is working out pretty well. We have it so flushed in there, and we're just doing it very, very carefully and slowly, that it's gonna look pretty flush and we won't actually need the trim. And of course, always remember that you need to apply pressure to the applied spots in order to set the glue. When you run into odd spots of the carpet where you're gonna have to seam it up like this, just make sure you have it lapped over it correctly, and then you just cut flush over both sides. The thickness of the 20 ounce carpet gives you a lot of leeway to get around odd stuff like this where it doesn't particularly seam up, where you don't have the same luxury with say EVA foam or hydro turf. You actually can get away with a lot on carpet. It's pretty DIY friendly. And now for the part where we actually cut the inside of the carpet out so we can eventually form the entire thing. We go ahead and start by cutting each end where we know it's going to crease. And then we give it a copious 1.5 inch like offset, where we cut a 1.5 to 2 inches out from the actual beam that the carpet is sitting on. And we do that because we know we're gonna have to fold the carpet over. So as long as it's cut there and it's cut in the corners like so, we'll be able to just seam it up. And I guesstimated that, but any overguesstimation is better than an underguesstimation. And you can clearly just cut that out with a utility knife. You'll have the corners right in there. You have to cut a little piece of like a triangle of the carpet and stick it in there. We've always had to do that. There's no way around it. It's just something you need to do. As long as you make sure that there's no glue residually pressed out when you set the carpet in there, you can stick the hatches in there and that will just absolutely hold the carpet against the hull and it'll form perfectly just like that. You won't have no problems. And now I can give you a better example of how do you start the creases in the end. This is a flat piece. We know it's going to crease there, so we cut there at like a diagonal end. Make an angled crut, because that's the best you can do in a corner where you can get the most usable space once you fold the carpet over on both sides. Other than that, it's just pretty rudimentary. It's very simple to do. And there's, again, a lot of leeway. Even if you totally just messed up and you cut it, you can still stick pieces of carpet in there and mush it together. And because it's all flurry and fluffy, it looks pretty good. You'd have to really profoundly screw up the carpet. like bad in order for it to not look good. We spared you from seeing some of the parts because some of the stuff, that other glue that we used that was recommended, it just didn't do the greatest as far as setting in cold weather. So we had some problems with it, but we eventually got this piece carpeted and then we attached the seats to it. The gentleman was pretty smart, whose boat this was. He kept all the initial hardware, kept all the other stuff, and so it made it really simple to do this. And now, the bigger part is attaching all the hatches back with the original hinges. And these were like not even stainless steel hinges. They were, I think they're cold rolled steel hinges. And that kind of stinks, but I would replace these with aluminum hinges. I just don't have it on hand, and it wasn't in the bulk part of the materials part for this project. So we're just gonna reuse the old hinges, but just so you know, if you see hinges that are rusted like that, it's because they weren't supposed to be in your boat. Anyways, this is how we actually make the hatches to fit. Now, in all boats that I've ever installed carpet on, I've had to trim the hatches, except for bunk carpet. You don't have to do this to bunk carpet. It's already too thin to trim. But for 20 ounce, especially 24 ounce, how you get it to look good once it's seamed in with hatches is you're gonna have to go in there and give it a haircut. Now, I'm kind of being very kind of rigorous, but I wouldn't trim it just like this. I would try to give it an angle so you don't see that giant line. But right now we're really just trying to trim this in to where the hinge can sit in there, because the hatches sit in there right now just fine without the hinges in there. And the carpet, if I minus the thickness of the carpet where the hinges are going to sit and I do it on the inside, then the hinges will sit in there and the hatches will sit in there just fine without binding once we have them all attached and they start to close and everything will close correctly. Earlier you saw me drilling through parts of the carpet before we formed it around the lid edges, and that was so we could find them again and have a marking to where we can clearly draw a line in for the rivets to go back in through the hinge into the lid. So on a few I forgot to do that, and I'll tell you, trying to find the hole even with like a needle or anything was really hard and very time consuming, so just make sure to mark it. We are going to go ahead and use, I think, almost just shy of 1 inch rivets, pop rivets, because rivets were what was holding the hinge to the carpet, to the hatch itself. So we have some here to go ahead and run that through again. Now we have some rivet washers, and what we're going to do is we're going to try and put those on the other side, though we're not going to be able to get them on every one. If you have a rivet washer on the side of something that's fragile, like plastic or fiberglass, and as the rivet mushrooms and pulls in, it has a substantially lower chance of cracking or pulling through said piece. We had a pretty good run with getting most of the washers on the other side of the rivets. Not all of them, though. Bear in mind, we're following somebody else's template, and somebody else drilled those holes into that hatch crooked, so we had to follow their template. But after that, we used screws inside the hole. Rivets inside to the hatch, and on the other side of the hinge binding it to the hole, there was like stainless screws, and that's what we got in there. We also replaced some of the shocks and actually gave some hatches some shocks that didn't have it. So pretty much all these compartments will have shocks by the time we're done. We paused on the back earlier. Now we're going to go ahead and seam it up and finish it up. We did pause on it for a second to get the front done because there were some things that where we just decided that was priority because of the weather changes. And now that that's done, we're going to go ahead and show you how we completed the back. Very, very similar. We edge the side of those parts there that are actually parts of the hull to how we did the hatch. And then it has other sections like this middle section that is a pretty integral part for all the hatches. It's a simple middle piece holding the pedestal mount for everything to seam up to. And in fact, it holds the live well hatch. This boat has dual live wells, one in the back, one in the front. Pretty interesting layout for older bass boats. We'll be right back. I'll tell you, that Lowe's glue, it saved me. That other glue, I would have been screwed in this weather. But everything came out fantastic. So this is how we handled the actual subfloor. Because the subfloor was pretty hard to template because the carpet ran up on each side, I actually chose to go a different route with it. I used spray adhesive. There is this stuff called 3M70 and 3M90 spray adhesive, which comes out in a pretty narrow nozzle, so it doesn't go everywhere. You do need to wear a respirator because you don't want to be breathing in glue. I mean, of all the chemicals to breathe in, that's terrible. So it worked pretty good because I needed leeway. Now, if I had to glue this whole thing, it would have caused me a lot of problems. It just would have. I would have had glue everywhere. It would have not seemed upright, could have gotten on the top of the carpet, all kinds of bad stuff would have happened. And really, the spray adhesive allowed me to get around all these intricate edges and up the walls and around and inside the steering console area and up this wall. And I gotta tell you, that's how we did this boat. I gotta say, for not doing carpet for a long time and being on this little turf craze, it was all right. It was nice to do carpet again. Make carpet great again. Because it really is, honestly, the toughest stuff. I know it's old, it's been around for a long time, and people are all stuck on this, like, EVA foam, hydro turf, sea deck, marine mat craze. But do not forget, for one second, that marine grade carpet is the toughest, most robust stuff you can have on a fishing boat. And that is just fact, from somebody who's installed both. I mean, think about it. Why do you think all the really high-end bass boats, all the like elite ones that are like $50,000, $60,000, $100,000 or whatever, why do you think they all come with carpet? Why do you think they come with relief foam carpet with the foam underneath and the carpet on top? It's because carpet's badass. Don't ever forget it. Thank you so much for taking time to watch this video. If you like this tutorial and you want to see others like that, check out our site, tbnation.net, click on tutorials, and it gives you a hyperlink to every last playlist I have for YouTube. You can see any series, see everything from just tutorials to other boat builds, along with our entire store, which has everything you need for projects just like this, including the carpet you saw used in this project. Thank you very much, guys. See you out there. Good luck.